Hello and welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent guest and leader for you, but before we go ahead, let me remind you to subscribe to the channel, check all the previous content, and also share with your communities in healthcare. Also, let me acknowledge our partners, the Digital Health Platform Clinitouch V, and our industry partner, Isaac Care. And today, it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Edward Marx. He's the Chief Executive Officer at Divurgent and also a former CIO at Cleveland Clinic and an author. Edward, how are you?
I'm doing really well. Thank you for having me. It's really a pleasure to be part of your program.
Oh, brilliant. Thank you for accepting the invite. I'm really excited about what we're going to share, and also I've been following your great work.
Well, thank you. Likewise, mutual admiration. I think what you're doing with your platform is really helping push digital transformation throughout healthcare globally. So I really appreciate all that you do. And you're a fellow footballer.
Ah, yeah. That's fantastic. Edward, today we are here to discuss digital acceleration, not transformation. And the first question that I have for you is, what is the difference between acceleration and transformation?
Yeah, so we've been talking about digital transformation for a long time now. We use different words in the past, but I would guess, 20 years we've been talking about digital transformation. Definitely use those words a lot in the last 5 years. But yet, when you look at the progress that we've made, you wonder how much transformation has really occurred. So I've really switched from the noun transformation to the verb of acceleration. So we all know we need to transform for a wide variety of reasons. But now we have to accelerate. And especially, if you think about it from a competitive nature, it's always good to accelerate while your competitors are sort of stalled a little bit. So that's what I mean by acceleration. We owe it to our patients and their families and the entire healthcare ecosystem to really double down on the speed and velocity of this transformation.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for these magnificent insights. And the second question that I have for you is, what are the two or three actions that organizations can take to accelerate?
Yeah, so one is really easy. And you and I would think, of course, everyone does this. But in fact, only 20% of organizations have this, and that's a plan. So it's hard. It's easy to get stuck, right, with digital transformation if there's no plan, because everyone's like, I don't know what to do. I know we need to do something. And then if they do something, then it's not coordinated or aligned with the overall vision and mission of the organization. So it's really about moving to an enterprise of excellence versus pockets of brilliance, right? You go to every organization, they're doing some great things, but it's not connected and it's not across the enterprise. So the first thing is have a plan, and it's not that hard. People think that it's too hard to do a plan, but if you don't have a plan and go through the thought processes and the negotiations and the communications and the collaborations, then it's really hard to get any meaningful work done. And I think that's one reason we've been stuck behind a little bit, is not having a plan. So that's the first thing. And the second is risk-taking. I could give you like five, but I know we're going to keep it to two. But the second would be risk-taking. And if you go back, I started watching F1, I never was a big formula. I was more into football, but I started watching F1 a lot. And you think about we talk about acceleration on the curve, right? Well, everyone else is putting on the brakes. If you accelerate out of the curve, you can get a lot of momentum. And the other thing is risks, right? The drivers take some calculated risks. And I think we've become so conservative in healthcare because we're dealing with patients' lives, and it's completely understandable why we have that culture. But when it comes to some of the things we're trying to do with digital, no one's life is at stake. So we need to be able to sort of be bimodal. Yes, be very risk adverse when it comes to actual hands-on patient care and the things that we do. But when it comes to the other areas that are in support of that, we need to be much more risk tolerant and accept failures. And see, it's a whole cultural thing, right? Because failure is bad in healthcare, because it could mean someone's life. It could, you know, mean a bad drug gets released or some bad protocol. But on the technology side, we certainly should be able to take more risks and embrace failure, right? That's what other industries do. They fail fast, embrace failure, and as a result, they're ahead of us. And so we need some of that culture to permeate into healthcare. So those are two things. Have a strategy, take more risks.
Oh, brilliant, Edward. I mean, it sounds like common sense, but pragmatic steps, but actually you are right. Not every organization have like a common strategy and the things are aligned is a bit fragmented and then they don't know what to do next. They don't know where to start. So yeah, fantastic. The third and last question that I have for you is, what happens if acceleration does not happen?
Yeah, well, I think we're seeing it now, at least in North America, where today the, like one example would be the organization that has the most physicians. Now, if I were to ask that question, you would think, oh, it's probably some big hospital, health system, but it's actually a payer. It's actually an insurance company. Now it controls the majority of primary care physicians in North America. And that's an example of the disintermediation that's happening because we took our foot off the accelerator. We didn't take the risk. We didn't create the plans. And so the payers then have said, hey, we understand that whoever controls the primary care sort of controls the downstream dollars, how they're invested, the decisions that are made. So they've gone up and bought up a lot of the primary care physicians. That's one example. Another example, and again, mine are mostly North America. I'm not sure exactly how they translate across the globe, but I'm sure there's some similarities. We have big tech moving in, right? We've seen Amazon start clinics. They say they're for their employees only, and I'm sure that's the case at first, but I think because of their supply chain capabilities of Amazon, you're going to see them continue to expand into healthcare, become a competitor to traditional healthcare players. So already you've seen now payers compete with hospitals that like they never have before. You're seeing big tech, and another is retail. So we have all these corner, what we'd call neighborhood, you know, corner stores, you know, like a CVS or a Walmart type of stores. And they've now added like the bulk of their space is being transferred into physical seeing patients, you know, patient care space. And of course, they're doing a lot of things virtually and they have a lot of revenue, especially during the pandemic, as well as payers. And so you're really seeing them come in and compete directly with hospitals and health systems where they used to partner. So it's very interesting, the different dynamics that are taking place. So you have these three huge disintermediation forces and a fourth one. And again, I could give you like 10, but I'll just stick with four. A fourth one is the emergence of virtual first organizations. So these are healthcare organizations that typically have both a physical and a virtual presence, but they start with the virtual presence. So it used to be that if you had if you were a hospital or a health system, you pretty much controlled whatever happened in your city or your region. But now because of the big tech, the retail play, everything, and I didn't mention Walmart's another example, is now they've come into your area. And because the world now is healthcare is now global. It's no longer local. It used to be local, now it's global. So if you don't do these things we just talked about, develop a plan to, and not really and when you develop a business plan, as you know, you'd understand all these different things. They would understand all these different things and then take actions and then take some risks. You're going to find yourself, you know, being taken advantage of at the margins, at the edges. And pretty soon all you'll be left is a core, and that core is not self-sustainable unless you have the entire ecosystem to help, you know, fund your entire program and your business and clinical operations. So that's what's going to happen, and we see it happening already.
Brilliant, Edward. Thank you so much. I do agree with you. The big players are interested in healthcare. We're seeing them making moves, and they have these capabilities and also the infrastructure. Unfortunately, it's bad news for the small and medium organizations because yes, they eventually will shrink the market by taking market share. But there is always room for those who do great innovation and people like us that are active and proactive. And Edward, we come to the end of the interview. I always finish in this way, but look, we have common interests. I'm also a triathlete fan. I have not trained for a while, but I know that you're very sports fanatic. I also like football. I like F1, and I always like the. You gave a perfect second example there on the second question. I always like the correlation between sport and business, because from sport we can actually take these performance examples, the way the mindset, the way they train, the way they act. And anyway, I mean, it's brilliant. Maybe we could have a separate sporting conversation, sporting interview.
But yeah. We could definitely learn a lot, right, from sport and other things that help people better understand when we give them examples from perhaps, you know, their hobbies. So, yeah. Yes.
Brilliant. Edward, I want to thank you for your time, for your expertise, for your magnificent work, and you have a really nice accolade career. I finish all my episodes in a peculiar way. It's called 1 minute of fame. You can talk about anything. You can talk about sport. You can talk about family. You can talk about work. You can talk about a shout out to any companies, your recent position, anything whatsoever. Over to you. 1 minute of fame.
All right. That's great. I love that. It's a great approach. Well, you know, you kind of alluded to it. I think it was something really sharp that you said, and that is that you don't, if you're a hospital in this situation, you don't have to fight all of these disintermediation forces. You can partner, right? So you can partner with retail. You can partner with payers. There's a lot of partnership opportunities. And then, so I think that's probably 20 seconds. My last 40 seconds, because this is top of mind for me, is if you can get out, I know it's hot right now as we record, but if you can get out, go out and do something. I recently climbed some mountains. I hadn't climbed mountains in a long time. And there were some mountains nearby. I happened to be in Colorado, which has a lot of mountains in the United States. And I just took the time to climb. And I know that life is short. You know, I've had a couple near-death experiences in my life. And life is short and precious. So go out and live. That's my message.
Brilliant. What a fantastic way to finish. Edward, I want to thank you again for accepting the invite and being here with us.
Thank you so much for having me. Such a joy. Thank you.
Brilliant. I'm going to round up now. To our viewers and listeners, make sure you subscribe to the channel. Also, follow the previous content. Share with your communities in healthcare. Great learnings here. Great content. Also, let me acknowledge our partners, the CliniTouch V Digital Health Platform and our industry partner. And also, I will include in here on the body of the recording Edward's LinkedIn and social media profiles. Connect with him. He's a true expert. Ask him questions, and I'll see you all next week.